الرحمن الرحيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. We will start surgery lectures by vascular surgery. Disorders of the arterial system produce a state of ischemia, which is defined as arterial insufficiency, in which arteries fail to deliver proper amount of blood to satisfy metabolic needs of the tissues. Arterial insufficiency may result in minor or major ischemia. Minor ischemia occur when the blood supply is only adequate at rest, but not with exercise. This will result in functional disability without any tissue damage. While in major ischemia, blood supply is not adequate even at rest. It induces both functional as well as structural disability because there is tissue damage in the form of degeneration, infarction, or gangrene. Ischemia may be induced by several causes. However, there are two different modes of presentation of ischemia. Ischemia may present as an acute condition, such as produced by embolism, thrombosis, trauma, dissection, etc. Or ischemia may present as a chronic condition, as produced by atherosclerosis, diabetes mellitus, vasculitis, etc. The most important presenting feature of ischemia is pain. Pain due to arterial insufficiency is characteristically claudication pain, meaning it occurs with exertion. In severe cases of ischemia, pain may be present at rest, and in cases of ischemic neuritis, paresthesia, numbness, and abnormal sensations may be present. If patient presents with trophic changes, this usually indicates severe form of ischemia. Examples of trophic changes are brittle nails, presence of trophic ulcers, hair loss, hyperkeratotic dry skin. The differential diagnosis of limb pain includes arterial causes, venous causes, nerves, and musculoskeletal. Arterial pain is characteristically, as we said before, exertional. It intensifies with activity, and it is associated with abnormal limb pulses. Venous pain is usually congestive, bursting pain. It is aggravated with prolonged standing, may be associated with history of DVT or varicose veins. It affects certain group of people whose jobs entail prolonged standing, like officers, like surgeons, etc. Nervous pain is usually sharp, lancinating pain, and it respects the dermatomal distribution of the affected nerve. Also, the pulses in this patient are usually intact. Musculoskeletal pain is a dull, aching pain which is felt in the joints or the limb more in the morning and less in the afternoon. It is usually associated with musculoskeletal disorders like osteoarthritis, myalgia, rheumatoid disease, etc. And again, pulses in this situation are usually intact. Examination of ischemic patient includes inspection, palpation, and special tests. Inspection includes inspection of the color. In this particular case, observe the dark color of the toes in contrast to the color of the dorsum of the foot. The dark color in this region is due to excessive extraction of oxygen from hemoglobin due to sluggish circulation. Also, you have to observe trophic changes such as brittle nails, loss of hair, thin, dry, atrophic skin. In some cases, you may find trophic ulcers. Edema may be found in ischemic cases. Edema may be induced by systemic or local factors. Systemic factors like cardiac edema, hepatic edema, renal edema, which are more frequent in ischemic cases. And edema may be induced by local factors such as infection, such as associated deep vein thrombosis. One of the important local causes of edema is disuse. Disuse of the affected limb is a common finding in ischemic patients because they refrain from using their limbs to avoid pain. Thus, static edema will develop, and this may add to their suffering. The next step is palpation. Palpation includes palpation of the major pulses in the limb, such as the femoral pulse in the groin, the popliteal pulse behind the knee, and the ankle pulses like the posterior tibial behind the medial malleolus and the dorsalis pedis in the proximal part of the first intermetatarsal space, just lateral to the extensor hallucis longus tendon. You have to determine the presence of the pulse and the volume of the pulse. The pulse may be felt with normal volume, or it may be less than normal, and this may be classified into weak pulse, barely palpable pulse, meaning difficult to be felt, or absent pulse. This reflects the severity of ischemia. Also, you can feel the temperature of the skin. The temperature of the skin reflects the degree of ischemia and level of ischemia. Usually, the level of coldness reflects the level of arterial insufficiency and block. For example, if you have cold foot, usually the block is in the tibial vessels. If you have cold leg, the problem is usually in the popliteal artery. If you have cold thigh, the problem usually is in the iliofemoral segment of arterial tree. Lastly, you have to look for swelling along the surface anatomy of the arterial system. If you have a swelling, consider the presence of aneurysm. And this swelling in this situation will exhibit true expansile pulsations concomitant with the cardiac pulse. Sometimes you may feel a thrill over the artery. Thrill is produced by turbulent blood flow in a stenotic segment of the arterial tree. Regarding clinical tests that can be done in cases of ischemia, the first will be auscultation of the vascular tree. Auscultation of the vascular tree can be done by the ordinary stethoscope or by a Doppler probe. If a stenotic segment is present in the arterial tree, the turbulence in blood flow in this stenotic segment will produce a specific sound that is called a bruit. The second test is to test capillary refill time. This test is done by applying pressure on the nail. This pressure will displace blood from capillary circulation, and this can be detected in the nail bed. Normally, the nail bed color is pink. With compression, when blood is displaced, it will become either pale or white. Releasing the pressure will permit blood to refill the capillaries within less than 2 seconds in normal conditions. However, in cold weather, this capillary refill time may be delayed as much as 5 seconds, but on no condition the capillary refill time should exceed 5 seconds. If it does exceed 5 seconds, this means ischemia. The same idea can be applied on veins. We ask the patient to lie flat on bed and raise the lower limb and observe the subcutaneous veins until they completely empty. Then we ask the patient to put his leg in a dependent position below the level of the table. And we observe the time at which the veins will refill. This time is normally from 5 to 15 seconds at most. If venous refill time is prolonged than 15 seconds, this indicates ischemia, because veins fill from arteries. If arteries are occluded, the inflow of blood is diminished, and consequently the outflow in veins will also be impeded. The last clinical test is Berger's test. Again, with the patient lying flat on his back, we observe the color of the sole. This is normally pink. We ask the patient to raise his leg for around 60 degrees on the horizontal, and we observe the color of the sole. In normal conditions, the color will not change. But if he has ischemia and sluggish circulation, the effect of gravity will impede blood flow to the sole, and the sole will become pale. The second step of this test is to ask the patient to put his leg in a dependent position below the level of the table, and we observe the color of the sole. In normal conditions, the color of the sole will be as pink as normal. But if this patient is suffering from sluggish circulation due to ischemia, excessive deoxygenation of blood will occur, and the blood will appear darker than normal, as well as stagnation of blood in the periphery will occur. This process will result in a specific color known as rubor, which is a bluish red discoloration of the soul on dependency. Thus, in ischemia patients, Berger's test is considered to be positive if the soul show pallor on elevation and rubor on dependency. Special investigations by arterial imaging may be done by either ultrasound examination using Doppler or duplex, or contrast arteriography. Doppler ultrasound examination of the vessels will assess blood flow, meaning it will assess the function of the arteries. We use in this test the Doppler probe in conjunction with the sphygmomanometer cuff. We apply the sphygmomanometer cuff on the lower part of the leg, and we continuously raise pressure inside the sphygmomanometer cuff till the pulse is completely absent in the ankle vessels, as detected by the Doppler probe, either in the dorsalis pedis or the posterior tibial. This will represent the systolic pressure of the leg. Then we repeat the same process in the upper limb. We put the cuff on the arm, and we put the Doppler probe on the brachial artery. We raise pressure, and we continuously raise pressure till the pulse completely disappear in the brachial artery. This will represent the systolic pressure of the arm. Normally, if we divide the systolic pressure of the lower limb on the systolic pressure of the upper limb, this ratio will result in a figure which is known as the ankle brachial pressure index. The normal value of this index is around 1 to 1.2. If this ratio decreases, this indicates ischemia. Thus, if it is below 0.9, ischemia is present. If it is below 0.7, there is severe ischemia. If it is below 0.4, there is impending gangrene. The next examination will be duplex arteriography. It is formed of using Doppler in the B mode. This enables imaging of the vascular tree. Imaging of the vascular tree will detect details of anatomical changes that occur in arteries in cases of ischemia. It can determine the exact site of the lesion and the nature of the lesion, whether it is atherosclerosis, thrombus, embolism, or calcification. Also, it can assess the arterial segment above the lesion, and this will enable assessment of the proximal run-on of blood flow. Also, it can detect the state of the distal arterial tree, and this will enable assessment of the so-called distal run-off of blood flow. These information are very helpful because they are essential to decision making for management of the arterial lesions. Let's now take a look on this photo. In this photo, we see a normal artery, which is color coded by the red color, and the nearby vessel is a normal vein, which is color coded by blue. Observe the lumen. It is free from any foreign material like thrombus or embolus, and the intima is smooth and there is no ulceration or calcification in the wall. Also, the diameter of the artery is even along its whole length. This is the normal vascular appearance in duplex. The appearance in pathological conditions. This is a chronic disease affecting the artery. Observe that the diameter of the artery here is normal, but from this point and distally, the diameter is very abnormal. In this region, it is affected by marked stenosis. And the diameter distal to this point, it is uneven. Sometimes it is small, sometimes it is medium-sized, sometimes it is nearly adequate, but it is uneven along the whole segment. Observe also the intimal irregularity. And this change affecting a long segment with intimal irregularity and abnormal appearance of the wall and the intima is usually indicative of atherosclerosis, which is a chronic ischemic process. Please don't forget also to look at the veins. As we said before, the veins fill from the blood returning from tissues. But if the artery do not provide blood flow to the tissues, the veins will appear empty, as occurring in this photo. This is the photo that shows another situation. The duplex show the arterial lumen here is patent, but the flow is turbulent. It is not a normal flow. The color coding shows that this is not red as usual. And there is abrupt arrest of blood flow at this point. And then the lumen of the rest of the artery appears empty. Thus, this is what occurs in acute ischemia, like an embolus. And the nearby vein is almost completely empty. And this means an acute process, not a chronic process like the previous one. The last imaging technique of vessels is angiography using a contrast, the so-called contrast arteriography. There are several methods to perform contrast arteriography. You can do the standard technique, the so-called Seldinger technique, or fluoroscopic angiography, CT angiography, or magnetic resonance angiography. The first contrast angiography technique is called the standard technique. This technique is done by direct arterial puncture by a special needle known as Seldinger needle. That's why sometimes this technique is known as Seldinger technique. After puncturing the artery with this special needle, we pass a guide wire inside the needle and we withdraw the needle. Then a special catheter is passed like an outer sheath around the guide wire. When the catheter reaches the vascular lumen, we can withdraw the guide wire outside the body. This is the catheter now inserted in the arterial tree, and it reaches up to the aorta. This is the external iliac artery, which starts to appear after contrast injection through the catheter. The external iliac artery will change into the common femoral artery below the inguinal ligament. Then the common femoral will divide into two branches, one medial and one lateral. The lateral branch will be near to bone, and it will not extend behind the upper half of the thigh, and it gives several branches. This is in contrast to the inner branch. This inner or medial branch is the superficial femoral artery. It is longer than the profunda, and it extends till the knee. And it is far from bone, and it does not give significant branches. This technique gives, as you see, still images only. And this limits its use, because it is not enough to have still images. You have to see moving images, and this gives you a better idea about the anatomy and the function of the arterial tree. In addition, direct puncture of the arterial tree is hazardous. It may be complicated by bleeding from puncture sites, and for maybe entimal dissection, disturbance of atheromatous plaque and distal embolization, and sometimes contrast injection in the artery produces vasospasm distally, which may be hazardous in ischemic patients. In addition to the chemical side effects of the contrast, like it may induce renal failure in susceptible patients, and it has some hypersensitivity reactions, which may reach up to anaphylaxis. This technique is rarely used nowadays because newer techniques are more accurate, and they can add a therapeutic potential to the procedure. The second procedure is fluoroscopic angiography. Fluoroscopic angiography is using the fluoroscopy device in visualization of the arterial tree. Fluoroscopy differs from the ordinary X-ray in that the X-ray is emitted and perceived on a specific fluorescent screen. This enables real-time moving images perception. It gives video, and this image can be visualized better, the so-called image enhancement, by two techniques: by adding image intensifier to the device, and by performing digital subtraction of the image. Digital subtraction is done by taking video prior to contrast injection, and another video after contrast injection, and subtracting the two images from each other, and this helps reduction of the shadow of bone and soft tissue, and this will result in better visualization of the arterial tree. Let's see this short video that will show us the appearance of the genicular vessel that will fill the popliteal artery distally and proximally. And as you see, the popliteal artery is filled from the genicular and not from the natural feeling direction from the superficial femoral above. This is called collateral circulation. This is another example of fluoroscopic arteriography. In this photo, you will see the angiography catheter inserted in the coronary vessels. Then you will see now, after injection of the contrast, the coronary vessels are visualized while the heart is beating. The next angiography technique is called CT angiography. This angiography is done without any arterial puncture. Thus, this technique is safe. It is done by injection of contrast in a peripheral vein, like on the dorsum of the hand or antecubital fossa. This decreases to a great extent the arterial puncture complications that is met with in the previous procedures. This technique can be also 3Ds reconstructed to give this picture, as you see in the photo, the aorta, the major branches like the celiac trunk, the superior mesenteric and inferior mesenteric, the renals, and the common iliacs. As you see, branches of the aorta are evident, they are clear. You see details, very fine details. For example, this is a celiac trunk, this is a left gastric artery, this is the splenic. You see the tortuosity and it's passing till it reaches the hilum of the spleen, and this is the hepatic artery and the different branches of it. This technique can be also color-coded. You can order the device to give the kidney a yellow color, a red color, to give the aorta the necessary color you like. This diversity will give you better visualization of the whole arterial tree. Another benefit of this technique is you can take CT photos for the whole body in a very short period of time, and you can have an idea about the vascular tree of the whole body, as this will help in decision making in management of ischemia cases. The last imaging technique of arterial tree is the magnetic resonance imaging. This technique is reserved to specific patients in whom we want to avoid the hazards of ionizing radiation and iodinated contrast. We use another type of contrast known as gadolinium. But this technique entails putting the patient in the device for a long time, nearly an hour or so, and it is much costly than other techniques. This is the MR angiography. It shows the aorta, the common iliacs, the external iliac artery with the profunda and superficial femoral arteries appearing on the left side. This is a small stenotic segment in the mid portion of the superficial femoral artery at the level of the mid thigh. On the other side, the right side, we see the iliac trunk, the femoral, the profunda femoris artery is well visualized, while the superficial femoral artery is suffering from a long segment of block. As you see, the artery is much attenuated, and there is filling of the distal segment from collaterals coming through branches of the profunda femoris artery. This is a case of right superficial femoral near complete block, and in the same case there is a stenotic area on the contralateral side. Principles of management of ischemia cases include: number one, modification of lifestyle. This includes: number one, stoppage of smoking; number two, modification of dietary habits, especially excessive consumption of injurious, harmful fat like the trans fat and saturated fat, and decrease intake of sugars. The third thing is encouragement of performance of physical activity. The second principle is to give drugs. The most important drug is to give antiplatelets in order to decrease the incidence of thrombotic complications. Also, drugs should be used to control other diseases that are commonly met with in cases of ischemia, like hypertension, diabetes, and dyslipidemia. The third principle is called transiluminal or endovascular minimally invasive surgery. By transiluminal procedures, we may use a balloon to dilate a certain stenotic segment of an artery, or even we can insert a stent to prevent restenosis. Surgery is performed if the occluded segment is extensive, long, or multiple. We can perform a bypass graft from the normal segment above to the normal segment below the lesion. Sometimes, in special situation like the carotid artery, which is a wide bore, high flow vessel, we can perform reboring of the artery, meaning we remove the atheromatous plaque surgically or endoscopically. Lastly, we may resort to amputation if gangrene occurs. There are several disorders that we are going to discuss in the next few slides. The first one is vasospastic disorders. The first arterial disorder that we are going to discuss is Raynaud's disease. Raynaud's disease is a vasospastic disorder that affects young females, and the incidence of which is around 4%. There is intense response to certain stimuli in the form of vasospasm. Some factors like cold weather, stressful conditions, or exposure to vibrating tools produce vasospasm. This is normally happened in all individuals. However, in some susceptible patients, like, as we said, young females, this vasospasm is severe enough to give this picture. There is, as you see, a severe pallor of the fingers. Due to development of severe vasospasm, the metabolism of this area of tissue will be anaerobic metabolism. This will result in production of anaerobic metabolites that will produce vasodilatation. Vasodilatation will result in resumption of the blood flow to these fingers, which suffered before from ischemia. because the tissue is hungry for oxygen, it will excessively extract oxygen from hemoglobin, producing excess carboxyhemoglobin. And this explains the bluish color that follow the pale color. So the first phase will be pallor, the second phase will be cyanosis. Lastly, after few minutes, the patient will pass into a state of intense vasodilatation and resumption of full circulation, and the color of the fingers will be plethoric. The blood will be excessively flowing and the vessels are still vasodilated. This will give the characteristic red color, which is called in this case rubor. So Raynaud's disease is a disease that passes through three phases. The first is pallor, the second is cyanosis, and the third and last one is rubor. After a few more minutes, the patient will be normal completely, and in between attacks of vasospasm, you cannot recognize any abnormality on the fingers. This photo shows severe attack of vasospasm, and the attack is also associated with gangrenous patches on the tips of the finger, and in severe cases, even after resolution of the vasospasm, there is tapering of fingers, lost nails, gangrenous patches, and in these conditions, the disease will become a chronic one. We see this not frequently in primary Raynaud's disease. It only occurs if the attacks are severe and last for a long time. This is rare. We usually see something like Raynaud's disease in association with underlying vascular disorders such as vasculitis. Cases of vasculitis may develop attacks of vasospasm. And in this situation, it is not called the Raynaud's disease, it is called Raynaud's phenomenon, showed by an underlying pathological disorder of the arterial tree. And in such condition, gangrenous changes usually develop, because there are two factors here: the underlying original disease like vasculitis, and in addition the vasospasm which produce Raynaud's phenomenon. This is a photo that shows gangrene of the distal part of the hand as well as the fingers. This case was inadvertently injected by a drug inside the artery. Sometimes critical patients are submitted to intra-arterial monitoring, especially during surgery, during intensive care admission. And if mishap occur, like wrong injection of some drugs inside the artery directly, the result will be intense inflammatory reaction and vasospasm of the arteries. And if the patient is unlucky like this one, he may develop gangrene. Atherosclerosis is the most frequent arterial disorder that affects nearly 100% of population. Athero means soft. It means gruel. يعني بالعربي العصيدة أو الفتة. Sclerosis means hardening. Hardening means ناشف أو قاسي. منين أثره soft وسكليره hard. The usual story starts by deposition of fat in the arterial wall. Then deposition of fat will be followed by macrophage clearance of this deposited fat. Thus, the fat intrusion inside the arterial wall is a continuous dynamic process of deposition and clearance, deposition and clearance. If this process of fat deposition is disturbed, fat will stay in the arterial wall and it will induce a state of chronic inflammatory disorder that eventually will result in degenerative changes in the arterial wall. This process starts usually in the middle age and is slowly progressive since then. There are predisposing factors that put patients at risk of having atherosclerosis by different intensity. The first is age. As we said, the higher the age, the more the atherosclerosis. Gender. It affects the male sex more than females. And that's why there is a postulation that female hormones have protective effect against atherosclerosis. Diabetes mellitus, hypertension, dyslipidemia, and smoking. Usually atherosclerosis affects large and medium-sized vessels. In this situation of atherosclerosis, the intima will be rough, ulcerating, and a thrombus may be attached to this rough area. The media will be fibrosed and show degenerative changes. Under the effect of intraluminal pressure in large arteries, the media may dilate, stretch, and form an aneurysm. In relatively smaller vessels, the fibrosis will induce stenosis of the arterial lumen with arterial blockage and consequently distal ischemia. This is a photo that shows the difference between the normal artery on the left side and the pathological atherosclerotic artery on the right side. This is a bisected aorta with the vasa vasorum ostia appearing in this photo-like small ostia, and the intima is clear and normal. On the right-sided photo, you see excessive fat deposition. This is yellowish areas, fibrosis, ulceration of the intima. And on this ulcer, thrombus may adhere. This is the exact pathological changes that starts in a normal artery. The fat is deposited here in the intima and inner part of the media, and with time, fat deposition increase, inflammatory reaction produced, fibrosis is progressive, and this induces thickening of the arterial wall and narrowing of the lumen with consequent ischemia. This is the cut section of an artery which show a normal thickness of the arterial wall in that side and excessive thickening of the arterial wall on the other side with fat deposition surrounded by fibrous tissue. Sometimes the pathologist called this a fibrous cap or sclerotic cap because the fibrous tissue surrounds the soft fat. In order to treat atherosclerosis, we may perform transluminal management. As you see, this is an artery that is affected by atherosclerosis, which induced thick wall and narrow lumen. We introduce in such artery a special instrument known as a vascular catheter. This vascular catheter is covered by a certain balloon, which is blue in color, and over this balloon, this is a stent, a vascular stent, like the figure of X. We perform dilatation of the artery by inflation of the balloon. The balloon will stretch the stenotic segment and will dilate this narrow segment, and the lumen will resume. However, sometimes if we just deflate the balloon and get it out, the artery will re-stenose again. And that's when we, before we withdraw the catheter, we leave a stent. This stent is self-expanding, and the value of this stent is to maintain the lumen open for a long time. This procedure is usually done under fluoroscopic control. As you see in this photo, the internal carotid artery is affected by a stenotic segment in its proximal part. And this is the external carotid artery, which gives branches in the neck. And of course, this is the common carotid artery. The procedure starts by insertion of a balloon catheter inside the external carotid. This is protective against dislodgement of any atheromatous plaque or thrombus to occlude the external carotid. Then we put a therapeutic catheter inside the internal carotid. This is to be used in arterial dilatation and stent insertion. The third one is, the third photo show insertion of the stent. The main trunk of the stent is put in the common carotid, and one limb of the stent is inserted inside the internal carotid artery. And please observe that the internal carotid artery resumed its full diameter. If you want to compare this with the original situation, it was very narrow, and this impedes the cerebral circulation to a great extent. This is a CT angio in the coronal plane that show the abdominal aorta and the iliac vessels. The apparent change is the presence of several plaques of atheromas with calcification affecting mainly the aorta and the proximal iliacs. And another change here is the presence of tortuosity of the aortic bifurcation. Despite this extensive atheromatous affection of the aorta, recognize that the lumen of the aorta is patent, and the iliac vessels are filled with adequate amount of contrast. And this is atherosclerosis without affection of the function of the blood vessels, because the lumen is normal. This is a CT angio that show the abdominal aorta with complete arrest of contrast in the abdominal aorta at the level just below the exit of the renal vessels. As you see, there is no contrast whatsoever in the distal aorta or iliac vessels. This problem is known as Lurich syndrome, or infrarenal complete aortic block. These patients usually suffer from bilateral lower limb marked disability, especially motor weakness, as well as disorders of erectile function in males. And these patients usually present to neurologists. And neurologists, if do not recognize that these patients are pulseless, they have ischemia and poor circulation in the lower limb, they may be misled and treat these patients as neurological cases, such as transverse myelitis or whatsoever. So please, when these patients present your clinic, consider infrarenal aortic block. Usually these are old age males which present with bilateral lower limb weakness and impotence. This is a CT with oral and IV contrast. Please notice that both kidneys show enhancement, and this is due to injection of IV contrast. And in the same time, the aorta does not show any enhancement, and the lumen appear to be devoid of any amount of contrast. Instead of this, the lumen is filled with a thrombus, and the wall shows calcification, which indicates atherosclerosis. This is the CT appearance of a case of Lurish syndrome. This is a case of superior mesenteric artery stenosis. This is another form of atherosclerosis. Atherosclerosis usually affects the start of a bifurcation area, like this area. The aorta is here, and this is the exit of the superior mesenteric, making an angle. At this point, there is stress from the flow of blood. The flow of blood produces stress on the arterial wall, and thus atherosclerotic changes appear in points of stress. You recognize here the superior mesenteric artery. The caliber of the superior mesenteric artery is normal, and there is a stenotic area at the origin of the superior mesenteric artery. These cases usually present with postprandial abdominal pain, much like the angina pectoris, which follow exercise. The exercise here in the intestine, which is supplied by the superior mesenteric, is eating. So usually these patients suffer from postprandial pain, the 3P's syndrome. They eat, and then after a period necessary for gastric emptying, around 1 to 1.5 hours, they develop abdominal pain. This is pathognomonic of superior mesenteric artery stenosis. These patients can be treated by transluminal management. We put a catheter inside the aorta. We negotiate the stenotic area in the ostium of the superior mesenteric, and we put a stent, and this will resume the caliber of the superior mesenteric. This is the post-stenting. And the third photo show a CT angio with digital reconstruction and color coding, and this show, of course, clearly that the superior mesenteric resumed its normal caliber again. If you compare this with the stenotic segment at the ostium of the superior mesenteric, you would see marked difference, and consequently the flow is resumed completely. This is a case of superior mesenteric selective angiography. You see here the catheter inside the aorta, and after injection of the contrast, the superior mesenteric artery is visualized with abrupt occlusion at its mid portion. Please observe the development of collaterals, extensive collaterals around the artery in an attempt to overcome the ischemia induced by this massive occlusion. The other photo is a CT angio in the sagittal plane. It shows the shadow of the heart and the aorta. And again, this is the superior mesenteric artery with abrupt occlusion of its at its middle, and distally there is no circulation whatsoever. And please observe also the collaterals around it in order to compensate for the occlusion. Another case of Seldinger technique or CT angio, in which the catheter is passed from the right side and introduced into the ostium of the left common iliac artery. The dye filled the left common iliac artery, but at the bifurcation into internal iliac and external iliac, there is a rest of dye in the external iliac artery. There is no external, no visualization of the external iliac artery whatsoever. The only vessel that fill from the common iliac is the internal iliac, and these are the famous branches of it, like the superior gluteal and the visceral branches, and these branches will give collaterals, as you see, around this area of occlusion, and this may maintain for some extent, as you see, the superficial femoral start to appear again, and this is due to filling from collateral circulation. And the source of collateral circulation is usually the internal iliac. This proximal occlusion usually gives chance for collaterals to fill the distal segment, and despite the obstruction is affecting a large artery, but the ischemia may be as this picture. The lower limb, as you see, is well perfused till the tips of the toes, but only the big toe suffer from a purple color. This is known as purple toe syndrome. Please recognize this problem. It indicates proximal block. So any susceptible case, old age, male, smoker, diabetic and hypertensive and dyslipidemic, presents to you on your clinic with purple toe, please consider proximal vascular block at the iliofemoral segment. This is a case of angiography. The catheter can be visualized entering from the left side. This is the catheter. It is entering the common femoral vessel, and it is advanced till the aortic bifurcation, and dye is injected. Please notice the left side. This is the common femoral. This is the superficial femoral and profunda. The profunda gives a lot of branches and ends at the mid thigh. The superficial femoral is normal in caliber, and the contrast reaches down to the knee joint. Please compare this side to the contralateral side. The left side show the contrast is filling the common femoral, and starting from the area of bifurcation here into superficial femoral and profunda femoris, there is very much attenuation of the vascular tree, both the superficial femoral as well as the profunda femoris. This area do not permit the contrast to fill the distal arterial tree. And observe the caliber of the superficial femoral is also narrowed. So this side suffers from a problem at the junction of the common femoral with the superficial femoral as well as the profunda femoris artery. It is an osteostenosis at this region. This is a case of lower limb ischemia that was submitted to CT angiography. Observe the right limb. This is the superficial femoral, popliteal, anterior tibial, tibioperoneal trunk, posterior tibial, and peroneal artery. The contralateral side, the left lower limb, observe this is the superficial femoral, and there is a rest of dye at this point. This is a famous point for occlusion. It is at the junction between the superficial femoral artery and the popliteal. It is called femoropopliteal block. This is a common site because the artery in this region is compressed by the adductor hiatus. The artery passes from the anterior aspect of the thigh to the posterior compartment through this hiatus. It seems that this is a stressful point because of the muscle contraction of the adductor hiatus on the arterial axis, producing characteristic block at this site. And if you follow the dye distally, there is no dye in this arterial segment, the proximal part of the popliteal. But again, the popliteal start to appear near the knee, and the distal circulation seem to be as normal as the other side. This means that collaterals from the vessel above obstruction, like this, that, and that, around three or four collaterals, succeeded to collateralize the obstruction and refeed the normal arterial pathway at this level and at that level and at that level, and the distal arterial tree was refilled from collaterals by collateral circulation, which sometimes is very efficient that it prevents gangrene. But usually this collateral circulation will not permit usual activity, and this patient will develop claudication. This is another case of direct angiography that show on the left side, the superficial femoral artery, the popliteal. The popliteal here is dividing into an anterior tibial and tibioperoneal trunk. Please compare this to the other side. This is the superficial femoral, popliteal, and there is a rest of dye at that region, nearly at the joint level. And there are collaterals arising from the proximal arterial segment in an attempt to overcome the stenotic or blocked area of the popliteal. The presence of collaterals here signify chronic condition. We can perform transiluminal interventional surgery under fluoroscopic control, and that's why it is called interventional radiology. You see, this is a case of popliteal block. You see, this is a superficial femoral, and this is a popliteal, and there is a blockage of the popliteal with failure of contrast to visualize the popliteal artery. The block is nearly at the proximal part of the popliteal artery, just below the femoropopliteal junction. This X-ray is followed by, it shows a catheter
put inside the lumen, and this catheter carry a balloon. The balloon is put aside the site of the stenosis. And the balloon is inflated. Inflation of the balloon will produce dilatation of the stenotic segment. Post-dilatation angiography showed that the superficial femoral artery inflow is now filling the whole popliteal artery, and this means successful balloon dilatation of the blocked popliteal artery. The next topic we are going to speak about is aneurysm. Aneurysm is localized dilatation of an arterial segment. The incidence of arterial aneurysm ranges from 2 to 5% of the general population. We may find aneurysm in any part of the body. As you see in these photos, the supraorbital and supratrochlear vessels are affected by aneurysmal dilatation. And this is the lateral view of the head that shows the superficial temporal artery aneurysm. And this is the angiography of such cases. This photo shows the chiasma and the relation to the cerebral vessels. As you see, this is the internal carotid artery, giving the anterior cerebral and middle cerebral vessels. And this is the vertebrobasilar system of blood supply of the brain. This is the basilar that gives the two posterior cerebral arteries. The two posterior and the middle and anterior cerebral all communicate around the chiasma, giving the famous circulation present at the base of the brain, known as the circle of Willis. Sometimes we may have aneurysmal dilatation at the circle of Willis. This is a cystic dilatation of part of the circle of Willis. As you see, this is the chiasma and this is the pituitary gland. This is normal angiography of the circle of Willis. Again, this is the posterior cerebral communicating with the middle cerebral and the anterior cerebral is communicating with the other one of the other side, making a complete circle that supplies the brain. Of course, the main source of the circle of Willis is the vertebral arteries to give the vertebrobasilar system and the carotid arteries that gives the anterior and middle cerebral system. Any occlusion of the feeding vessels can be compensated for by collaterals from the circle of Willis. This photo shows aneurysmal dilatation of part of the circle of Willis, and this aneurysm is hazardous because any brisk increase in blood pressure may induce spontaneous rupture, and this will produce intracranial hemorrhage with its hazardous consequences like brain compression and even colonization. This is the clinical situation when the aneurysm ruptured. There is extensive subarachnoid hemorrhage, which is a situation that may lead to increased intracranial tension. As you see in this photo, this is the aneurysm, which is filled with excessive amount of blood, hematoma formation. There is blood here also, there is clots here, and this metal probe is put inside the perforation that led to all of this ominous complications. Another common site of arterial aneurysm is the carotid artery aneurysm. It usually presents by a swelling in the carotid triangle. The swelling is cystic, pulsatile. The pulsations are true expansile pulsations, and it is compressible, and it regains its full size in single heart beat. This is the angiography of the carotid aneurysm. It showed the common carotid and the external carotid, while the internal carotid is like a pyriform mass which is filled with the contrast. This case was treated by endovascular surgery by insertion of a catheter, as you see, and coil insertion was done. Coil insertion, beads and sclerosant materials of different types may be used to avoid major surgery for excision of the aneurysm and reconstruction of the artery. This is after coiling of the carotid artery with marvelous result, as you see. The swelling almost disappeared. This is an operative finding of the carotid aneurysm. The aneurysm is present here. This is the common carotid. This is the internal carotid. This is the external carotid. And the aneurysm was resected all together with the internal carotid, and replacement of the internal carotid by an autogenous vein graft was done in this condition. Another case of aneurysm is aneurysm of the ascending aorta. You see here the ascending aorta is markedly dilated, and it is full filled by a large intra-aneurysmal blood clot. In this situation, thoracotomy was done, and the aneurysmal part of the ascending aorta was resected and replaced by a synthetic graft. This is a case of the abdominal aorta, as you see, and this is aortic bifurcation, and this is the renal vessels. You see the infrarenal abdominal aorta is affected by an aneurysm. This is the most common site of aneurysm of the aorta, in the infrarenal site. And this site is usually atherosclerotic. Aneurysmal dilatation of an artery may occur due to congenital causes like perianeurysm, or acquired causes like degenerative changes in the artery that will weak the arterial wall, such as atherosclerosis, such as vasculitis, such as post-traumatic, etc. The most common type of abdominal aortic aneurysm is this type. Again, it is in 95% in the infrarenal site, and in 95% these aneurysms are atherosclerotic aneurysms. This is a CT angio that show infrarenal aortic aneurysm. And as you see, the risk calcification of the aneurysm and the aorta and the iliac vessels, and these calcifications points to the cause of the aneurysm, which is again atherosclerosis. This is a CT angio with color coding and reconstruction. You see the abdominal aorta is affected by an aneurysm in the infrarenal part, and it is extending near to the aortic bifurcation. This is another case of aortic aneurysm. It is affecting the distal aorta below the renals, but it is involving the aortic bifurcation and the proximal portions of the common iliac vessels. So this is called aortoiliac aneurysm. This is a CT that shows enormous dilatation of the aorta. The aorta usually has a diameter of around 2.5 centimeters. And it was determined that if the diameter of the aorta is more than 5.5 centimeters, this will carry a very high incidence of rupture. It is of paramount importance to measure the diameter of the aneurysm, because if it is large, this calls for emergency management. This is a case of abdominal aorta, which show aneurysmal dilatation of its distal part, encroaching on the aortoiliac region, with intramural thrombus, as you see, filling its cavity. This is a CT that show a very important phase of aortic rupture. As you see, this is the aorta, and the wall is thinned out and calcified. This is the functioning lumen of the aorta that is filled with contrast. And the contrast indicates that this is the part of the aorta that transmit blood flow. This is a mural thrombus of the aorta. And at this site, there is starting rupture of the wall, dissection of the aortic wall, and there is contrast leak, but this leak is still contained within the lumen. This is called intramural rupture. As you see, the intramural rupture will permit extravasation of the blood to the wall of the aorta. And as you see, the wall of the aorta is very thin and atrophic. So if the blood pressure of this patient increases at any time, rupture of the aneurysm is imminent. This is a CT in the sagittal view. This is the arch of the aorta, and this is the descending aorta. This is the abdominal aorta. This is the functioning lumen. This is an intramural thrombus, and the wall of the aorta is calcified. And observe the diameter of the aorta is rather large. The diameter of the underlying vertebral bodies is around 3 centimeters. And if you compare this with that, the diameter of the abdominal aorta is more than 5 centimeters. This indicates impending rupture. This is hazardous. This patient should not be managed conservatively. This photo shows the abdominal aortic aneurysm. This is the inferior vena cava, and this is the left renal vein. We approach the aneurysm of the aorta by a retroperitoneal approach from the left side of the patient. We reflect the peritoneum with the viscera anterolaterally towards the right side, toward the right side. Then we expose the front of the aortic aneurysm. Then we bisect the aortic aneurysm, we open the aneurysm, and we put this graft. We suture the graft above to the rest of normal aorta, and below to the region of aortic bifurcation. Then we use the aneurysmal wall itself as a protective flap that will cover the aortic graft. Let's see this short video that is downloaded from the YouTube about endoscopic stenting of aortic aneurysm.
Your surgeon will perform an abdominal aortic aneurysm repair to prevent the rupture of a bulging area of your aorta. Endovascular aneurysm repair. Your surgeon will begin by making a small incision in your groin over your femoral artery. Then he or she will insert a guide wire into the artery and gently push it up toward the site of your aneurysm. A catheter or hollow tube will be passed over the guide wire and pushed toward your aneurysm. Using live X-ray pictures as a guide, your surgeon will pass an endovascular stent graft, a compressed fabric and metal tube, through the catheter to the aneurysm. Then he or she will open the graft, which will be held in place with metallic hooks and stents. Your surgeon may insert additional graft components to extend the graft into the blood vessels supplying your legs. Once the graft is in place, your blood will flow through it, not into the surrounding aneurysm sac, which will remove the pressure from your aneurysm. Finally, your surgeon will remove the catheters and close the incisions in your groin. The procedure will generally take 2 to 3 hours.
After insertion of the stent, this will be the appearance of the metallic part of the stent put in the aorta and the parts that are put in the common iliac vessels. Please, when you have a pulsating swelling, which is dark in color, if it is overlying the surface anatomy of a known major vessel, like this groin swelling, please consider ruptured aneurysm. The aneurysm may present like an abscess in this situation. Please, please don't incise this swelling. Take your time to feel pulsations. You may need ultrasound assessment, Doppler or duplex. This will be conclusive and this will diagnose the issue. If you incise this swelling, you may lose your patient's life. This angiography shows the arterial tree of the lower limb. This is the superficial femoral artery, and this is the popliteal artery. From the proximal segment of the popliteal, a localized swelling arises, and this swelling is filled with contrast. This is cystic dilatation of the popliteal artery. This is a popliteal artery aneurysm that is not filled with a thrombus. It is still without thrombosis. This is a photo that show the radial artery aneurysm that is pointed to by this yellow arrow. Sometimes when we insert a cannula in the radial artery for invasive monitoring of critical patients, after withdrawal of the cannula, the site of arterial puncture heal by weak fibrous tissue that yields with time, resulting in this awkward situation, radial artery aneurysm. The next topic that we are going to speak about is vasculitis. Vasculitis is an inflammatory process that may affect vessels in around 5% of the general population. The etiology of vasculitis include autoimmune disorders like rheumatoid arthritis and systemic lupus erythematosus, infection either by bacteria or viral infection or other organisms, and it may be induced by drugs. The most frequently used drugs that produce vasculitis are antibiotics, such as penicillin, sulfa, cephalosporins, quinolones, etc. Other drugs that may produce vasculitis are non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, diuretics, anti-epileptics, immunosuppressive drugs, anti-helminthic drugs, and a lot of others. Clinical picture of vasculitis is rather non-specific. Usually patients present with fever, headache, malaise, weakness. However, if your patient present with arthralgia and skin rash, please consider vasculitis. Vasculitis may present by several clinical types, such as Berger's disease, Behcet's disease, Henoch's purpura, Takayasu disease, and others. This is a case of Berger's disease. In Berger's disease, the inflammatory reaction involves the whole neurovascular bundle, the artery, the vein, and lymphatic channels, or are involved by vasculitis and thrombosis, which occludes the lumen of all vessels. Thus, patients experience gangrene from the start due to occlusion of arterial channels, venous channels, and lymphatics. And these patients, due to involvement of the nerves, complain from wrist pain very early. This is a photo of a patient suffering from Berger's disease in which there is 4-foot gangrene, as well as signs of ischemia in the proximal part of the foot. And this is the angiography of the same patient. As you see, the angiography show that the vessels in the leg stop at the level of the ankle and no visualization of vessels in the foot whatsoever. And this explains the severe degree of ischemia that led to gangrene. This condition usually affects middle-aged persons. Male gender is more affected than females, and it specifically affects smokers more than non-smokers. This disease usually affects vessels below the level of the knee in the lower limb and vessels below the level of the elbow in the upper limb. This angiography is a case of Berger's disease. This part is the leg. As you see, the leg vessels are almost absent. The anterior tibial, the posterior tibial, and the peroneal cannot be detected in this angiography. The blood supply of the leg is maintained by only this plexus of collaterals derived from small dermal vessels, intramuscular vessels, and others. This plexus is not enough at all to give adequate blood flow to meet the metabolic demands of tissue. This is a case of Berger of the fingers. As you see in the left-sided photo, the index, the middle finger, and the little finger are affected by gangrene. the ring finger is spared from gangrene. And this is the angiography of the same case. It shows obstruction of the digital vessels of the index, of the middle, and of the little finger. And there is preservation of a single digital vessel of the ring finger. And this is the cause of viability of the ring finger of this case. Another type of vasculitis is Takayasu disease. Takayasu disease is arthritis of great vessels or large vessels. It usually affects large vessels, especially the aorta. As you see in left-sided photo, it shows angiography of the aortic arch and the great vessels. This is a normal angiography. In this photo, we see the ascending aorta markedly dilated, and compare it to the descending aorta, it is more than 2 times the diameter of the descending aorta due to weak arterial wall of the ascending aorta, as it is affected by Takayasu arthritis. This is a CT angio with reconstruction and color coding. You see the ascending aorta here, the arch of the aorta, and the descending. You see the aortic wall here is abnormal. It is full of wrinkles, slight dilatation of this area, and stenotic areas at that point and at that point. Also, the great vessels are affected by the same changes, areas of stricture and areas of dilatation. Behçet's disease is a disease of the uveal tract, and it is associated with orogenital ulcers. As you see, this is an ulcer of the lower lip mucosa as well as the left labium majus. Another disorder is the Henoch-Schönlein purpura. The usual clinical picture is the presence of purple spots on the skin, commonly seen on the lower limb and trunk. However, these spots leave normal areas in between, and in severe cases, they may join together and result in a widespread affection of intense vasculitis and dermal affection up to spots of gangrene, like these dark areas. The severity of the condition may be as high as performing a major tissue loss, like these gangrenous patches, which after sloughing will leave ulcers. Vasculitis of the kidney is very common. There is around 9 or 10 syndromes of renal vasculitis. This picture is representing renal vasculitis, and it is apparent on the outer surface as well as on the cut section of the kidney. It spares no part of the kidney. The whole kidney is affected. And in the cut section, it affects the cortex as well as the medulla. The results of this extensive vasculitis is parenchymal damage, and it may end in end-stage renal failure. The gross appearance of the kidney is like a flea-beaten kidney. Diabetic foot syndrome is a special entity. In this entity, there is a collection of disorders. The first is vasculitis. Vasculitis may affect small vessels, and in association of small vessels, also diabetic arthritis may affect large and medium-sized vessels because it induces acceleration of atherosclerotic changes. Thus, this patient usually suffers from ischemic changes. As you see, the forefoot is ischemic. There is heel, peeled skin, and at the most distant part of the foot, the tip of the big toe, there is gangrenous patch, which is typical for ischemic ulcer. Not only the vessels are affected in diabetic foot, also the nerves. Due to affection of nerves, there will be motor weakness and claw toes, and most importantly, neuropathic ulcers. As the patient is not feeling well at the sole of the foot due to peripheral neuropathy, the pressure areas will suffer from ulcers. This is a typical site of a pressure ulcer due to neuropathy. These ulcers are usually present on the metatarsal head region and sometimes proximal in the sole, in the under the calcaneus or the lateral border of the foot. Important problem in diabetic foot is weak immunity, the so-called immunopathy, because diabetes interferes with all immune mechanisms of the reticuloendothelial system and organs responsible for immunity. Thus, in diabetes, recurring infection is frequent. All of these disorders may join together, giving the full-blown picture of diabetic foot syndrome, like this photo. There is infection, there is ulceration due to neuropathy, and there is gangrene due to angiopathy. Tumors arising from angiomatous tissue are rather rare. They include carotid body tumor, which may present in the carotid triangle. Swellings in the carotid triangle may be lymph nodes, carotid body tumors, carotid aneurysm, or branchial cyst. Lymph nodes are oval or kidney-shaped, and usually they are multiple. Carotid body tumor is a solid tumor. Carotid aneurysm is a cystic lesion which exhibit true expansile pulsations. Branchial cyst is a non-pulsatile cyst. Carotid body tumor is a rare vascular tumor. It arises from chemoreceptor cells from the carotid body, which is situated within the adventitia at the common carotid bifurcation. Carotid body tumor usually present with a mass. This mass is oval in shape. The upper border of the mass can extend up to the skull base, while the lower border of the mass usually stop at the level of carotid bifurcation, which is clinically at the level of upper border of thyroid cartilage, which is almost at the level of C3 or 4. The carotid bifurcation seems to stop the lower extension of the tumor below this level. The lateral extension of the tumor is hampered by the external carotid artery anterior and the internal carotid artery posterior. However, outward extension induces splaying of the external carotid and internal carotid apart from each other. That's why this tumor is called a potato tumor, because of the characteristic oval shape. In CT examination, we can see on the right side, the external carotid is pushed anterior and the internal carotid is pushed posterior. This wide separation of the external and internal carotid is characteristic of carotid body tumor. In the CT examination here, this is a sagittal view, which clearly delineate the wide separation of both external and internal carotid artery, and this separation is described in radiological pictures as the V sign. This is a photo of the normal anatomy of the carotid artery. This is the main trunk of the common carotid, the site of bifurcation, with the external carotid and internal carotid parallel to each other, like the figure 11. If carotid body tumor is present, as in this case, it will induce separation of the external carotid and internal carotid, making the V sign. Another tumor that arises from angiomatous tissue is Kaposi sarcoma. Kaposi sarcoma arise from endothelial cells and stromal cells. That's why it is described as sarcoma. Infection with herpes virus type 8 may be an inducing factor of this disorder. Also, this disease is more frequent in immune deficiency conditions and chronic lymphedema. The disease may appear on the surface epithelium of the skin and or the mucus lining of internal structures, and even it can affect solid organs. Usually, Kaposi sarcoma of the skin produce dark patches or nodules that may coalesce together, giving large areas of dark coloration, and the nodules here are hard. This is another Kaposi sarcoma of the region of the palate and Kaposi sarcoma of the rectum. Congenital disorders of blood vessels include hemangioma and other disorders. Hemangioma is actually a hamartoma of vascular tissue. It may affect capillaries, veins, lymphatics, or other tissues. Capillary hemangioma may present as a skin patch with this reddish vesicular appearance, and this is known as Salmon's patch. Or it may present with a large elevated lesion with intense red color, like a strawberry, and this condition is known as strawberry hemangioma. Hemangioma may also occur from cavernous tissue, that is to say, it may arise from venous channels. Lastly, hemangioma may affect lymphatic tissue, and in the skin it may present with this lesion, which is slightly elevated from the surface, with small vesicles and solid nodules. This is called cutaneous lymphangioma. Lymphangioma may also affect deep lymphatics. This photo shows a large cervical swelling that induced deviation of the head to the contralateral side. This is a case of cystic lymphangioma of the cervical region. This case may present during labor by obstructed labor, because the presence of this swelling will induce hyperextension of the neck, and instead of the child being presenting with vertex presentation, he will be presenting with a face presentation, and this induces difficulty during passage through the genital tract, and this may be an indication of a cesarean section. Angiomatous malformation may also affect arteries. One of the common sites of arterial malformation is the digital vessels. This angiogram shows angiomatous malformation of the digital arteries, especially affecting the ring finger and the distal part of the hand. Angiomatous malformation may also affect mesenteric vessels. In this particular photo, it shows the superior mesenteric artery and the upper jejunal branches arising from its left border is going to the left side to supply the upper jejunal intestinal loops. However, instead of fading away at the periphery, they started to form a plexiform angiomatous malformation. This malformation may present in the mesentery or in the gut wall itself, and later on it may induce gastrointestinal bleeding. Angiomatous malformation may also affect the inferior mesenteric artery. As you see in this photo, the inferior mesenteric artery is ending by a plexiform mass of vessels. This plexiform mass is occupying a great deal of the pelvis. In addition, this photo shows an extravasation of dye at this point marked by the white arrow, and this may produce internal hemorrhage. Aortic coarctation is usually treated surgically. Observe the stenotic area at the end of the aortic arch. This area is usually followed by an area of post-stenotic dilatation. Because of this change in the aorta, this area should be resected and replaced by a graft. Observe the second photo in which the aortic coarctation is present and the post-stenotic dilatation after it marked by the black arrow. This is a view through a thoracotomy incision. This pathological area is resected and a synthetic graft is put to replace the pathological part of the aorta. This is a contrast radiography that shows the catheter inside the aorta, and the dye is injected in the aorta. It shows the left renal artery with early division and the right renal artery which suffers from this pathological change. As you see, there is consecutive stenotic areas along a long segment of the right renal artery. This appearance is typical and characteristic of a disease process known as fibromuscular dysplasia. This disease may produce renal artery ischemia, and with time, it may induce block of the renal blood flow. The next entity to be discussed is arterial compression syndromes. In this entity, we will discuss arteries that are compressed by certain agents, and this will produce ischemia, or arteries compressing other structures, and this will produce relevant symptoms. Compression syndromes are multiple. The subclavian artery may be compressed at the thoracic outlet, producing the famous thoracic outlet syndrome. The celiac trunk may be compressed by hypertrophic median arcuate ligament of the diaphragm. The superior mesenteric artery and the aorta both will act as a nut cracker, producing compression either on the third part of the duodenum and or the left renal vein. The left iliac vein may be compressed by the right external iliac artery. The popliteal artery may be entrapped and compressed by the medial head of gastrocnemius. The ureter may be compressed at different levels by different arteries. High at the pelvic-ureteric junction, it may be compressed by the accessory renal artery. In the middle of the ureter, it may pass behind the inferior vena cava as a retrocaval ureter. The cava will compress the ureter, producing hydroureter and hydronephrosis. And lastly, the ureter at its during its passage at the pelvic brim may pass behind the external iliac artery, producing compression on the ureter and back pressure on the kidney. This is a rather busy slide. However, it includes in consecutive columns the necessary data. The first column includes the name of the syndrome. The second column includes the compressed structure. And the third column includes the cause of compression. And the next column includes the clinical picture relevant to the condition. And the next column includes the CT findings. The last column includes the principles of management on each specific case. This is the photo of a famous soprano from Spain. She is an opera singer in Madrid Opera. Please observe the scar in the left supraclavicular region through which an operation of cervical rib resection was done to treat the upper limb manifestations induced by the compression syndrome of the subclavian artery and the lower course of brachial plexus. This is a 3D CT that shows the clavicle on the right side and the subclavicular space through which the subclavian artery pass and the lower course of the brachial plexus. This is the normal first rib. Please observe the other side of this case in which there is an accessory rib here. in the cervical region. This is a cervical rib. Observe that the accessory rib pass underneath the clavicle to be inserted or attached to the upper surface of the first rib. This rib induces narrowing of the subclavicular space and consequently compression of the structures passing through this space. The right-sided photo show the cervical rib passing underneath the clavicle and inserting in the upper surface of the first rib. Observe, please, the subclavicular space at the pathological left side and compare it to the subclavicular space on the normal right side. This is a CT of the thoracic outlet. You see here the cervical rib, which is present only on this side and not on the other side. This rib is narrowing the space below the clavicle. Compare this space with that space. This is a wider space that permit the vessels to pass easily from the neck to the axilla, but here the space is narrowed by this bony structure. This angiography shows the subclavian artery passes underneath the clavicle. This is the shadow of the clavicle. Then the subclavian is transformed into the axillary artery. Please recognize that the part or the segment of the subclavian artery just underneath the clavicle is suffering from an ectatic area. There is dilatation here. This ectasia, marked by this yellow arrow head, is induced by the continuous friction of the clavicle, and the artery is compressed in between the clavicle above and the first rib and cervical rib below. Continuous friction of this region induced degenerative changes in the arterial wall, and the arterial wall will be weak and it dilates, as you see in this photo. Thrombosis may occur at this site because of the roughened intima and the turbulent blood flow from ectasia. Not only this, but also with movement of the upper limb and the continuous friction of this pathological region, the thrombus may fragment and send the distal emboli. And this is what happened actually in this case, and the fragmented, dislodged thrombus was impacted here in the axillary artery, producing axillary artery embolism. This is a CT in the sagittal plane. This CT shows the aorta in front of the vertebral bodies. Please notice two structures. The first is marked by the arrowhead. This is the compressed celiac trunk. The second is marked by the arrow from above. This is the hypertrophic median arcuate ligament. Please notice that the superior mesenteric artery lies just below the celiac trunk. Observe the difference in caliber between the superior mesenteric and the celiac. There is marked attenuation of the celiac trunk. The second photo here shows the celiac trunk with stenotic area at its origin and the superior mesenteric normal trunk below it. This is a 3D CT angio. The third photo shows the same patient, but after a release of the compression induced by the median arcuate by splitting the fibers of the median arcuate ligament. Please notice that the celiac trunk regained its normal diameter, and compare this to the previous one with marked stenosis and the first picture. The next syndrome is the nutcracker syndrome. The conventional nutcracker used to crack and break the shell of nuts is the source of this nomenclature. This problem of compression in between two vertical structures can be imitated in this situation. The first vertical structure is the aorta, and the second is the superior mesenteric artery. If the distance between the superior mesenteric artery and aorta is narrowed, the structures passing through this narrow space will be compressed. This is called the nutcracker effect. Normally, there is a distance which is adequate to accommodate the structures normally. This distance is known as the aortomesenteric distance, and it should not be less than 10 millimeters. And also, some authors like to specify the aortomesenteric angle as being not less than 25 degrees. But the aortomesenteric distance is more important. Observe in this film on the right side, the aorta here and the superior mesenteric artery is there, and the aortomesenteric distance is very narrow. Compare this distance to that one. This is a normal distance, and this is the narrow distance. Thus, this patient will suffer from nutcracker syndrome. The first structure that may be compressed by the nutcracker effect is the third part of the duodenum that passes transversely from right to left underneath the superior mesenteric. And this will produce dilatation of the proximal part of the duodenum as well as the distal stomach. This is nutcracker syndrome inducing duodenal obstruction. This is, of course, an upper gastrointestinal contrast series, the so-called barium meal. The photo in the middle show coronal view of a CT exam, and the same appears here. The compressed area of the duodenum is at the anatomical site of the superior mesenteric vessel, and the duodenum proximal to it is markedly dilated. The photo on the right side show the vertebral body with the aorta in front and the superior mesenteric. The superior mesenteric artery is marked by red arrow, and the aorta is marked by blue arrow. The aortomesenteric distance is very narrow, compressing the duodenum. And the duodenum proximal to the nutcracker effect is dilated, and it is marked by the black arrow. Another structure may be compressed by the nutcracker effect due to narrow aortomesenteric distance. This structure is the left renal vein. This is the shadow of the kidney, and this is the renal vein arising from the hilum of the kidney, and the renal vein passes in this region between the superior mesenteric anteriorly and the aorta. It is apparent that this aorto-mesenteric distance is narrow, and this produced congestion of the left renal vein and the kidney. This patient may present with left loin pain and even hematuria. This is an MRI of both lower limbs just below the region of the knee. It represents the popliteal area. This is the popliteal artery on the left, and this is the popliteal artery on the right. You see, the popliteal artery passes behind the condyles of the femur, entering the leg and dividing into anterior tibial and the tibioperoneal trunk. This side is normal. Compare this side to the other side. Look at this area, which is marked by the yellow arrow. The area of the popliteal artery marked by the yellow arrow is obstructed. There is no contrast passing through the popliteal artery. However, collaterals succeeded to fill the distal segment of the popliteal and to maintain the blood flow through the tibial vessels. The popliteal block at that region may be induced by several causes, such as atherosclerosis. But in this particular situation, you can suspect compression syndrome if this lesion occur in young age. And in this condition, you can find in MRI cuts, you can find hypertrophic medial head of gastrocnemius muscle. One of the important disorders of vascular structures is infection. Infection of vessels will produce vasculitis and thrombosis. And thrombosis of the vessel will result in ischemia of the relevant tissue supplied by these vessels. There is a very special entity known as necrotizing fasciitis. It occurred due to infection with multiple types of bacteria. It is sometimes called pneuma. Pneuma means spreading gangrene. What occurs in this situation? Polymicrobial infection of the skin and subcutaneous tissue can spread easily in the subcutaneous plane, producing vasculitis and thrombosis of perforator vessels that supply the subcutaneous tissue, the fascia, the fat, as well as the overlying skin. Occlusion of the feeding perforators to the skin will result in gangrene of the overlying skin. Because it is a polymicrobial infection, this induces spreading gangrene because it usually occurs in immunosuppressed patients like addicts, like diabetics, like cases with immune deficiency diseases. One of the common regions that can be affected by necrotizing fasciitis is the perineum. And this infection is usually known as Fournier gangrene. It can affect males or females. The photo on the left side show Fournier gangrene of the scrotum, mainly on the left side. The photo of this poor female show gangrene that affects the right labium magus. Please note the surrounding inflammatory reaction in the lower abdomen, erythema and edema, and also in the inner thigh and in the perineal body region and around the anus. Necrotizing fasciitis may also affect the region of the face. And if you notice that this poor patient lost his soft tissue as well as teeth, nose, cheek, even the whole cheek is lost with debridement, antibiotics, and supportive measures. This is the present state. You see, the whole nose is lost. The bone even of the maxilla and mandible is also lost, as well as the lips and a great deal of the cheek. The same necrotizing fasciitis of the face for this poor lady led to a loss of the covering of the cheek and lips with exposure of the teeth. Of course, this is a tube used for feeding. Necrotizing fasciitis may also affect the abdominal region. This is necrotizing fasciitis of the lower abdomen. You see gangrene of the lower abdomen surrounded by inflammatory reaction and edema with redness. This is the same patient after liberal debridement till we reach the normal healthy tissue. Necrotizing fasciitis may also affect injection sites. This is a patient lying on his left side. This is the gluteal region, and this is the famous site for injection. Sometimes necrotizing fasciitis is induced by aseptic injection or injection with an irritant material, especially non-steroidal antibiotic and vitamin preparations, etc. If you don't make the injection under strict aseptic conditions, especially in immune-compromised patients like diabetics and patients on immunosuppressive drugs, you may be confronted with this patch of gangrene.